We're designing a building for the community in what it will be used after the games. It's the largest speed skating facility in North America that we can convert into 8 basketball courts, 2 Olympic sheets of ice, and a 200 meter indoor track.
My favorite thing about this building is that it's a creative resolution of so many aspects of design. It's a successful resolution of tremendous structural factors. The program of the building calls for a clear span of approximately 100 meters. So we are talking about a potentially cavernous space which needs to be humanized and which needs to hold people's interest. The roof really becomes the expressive element of the building as a whole. It combines in the structural design the kind of the architectural aspirations that we've always had for the building, the idea of flight and the idea of material appropriateness to the site. It needed to be, and it will be, an iconic presence.
Well, it was not long after Vancouver was awarded the 2010 Olympics, and it became apparent very quickly that there was going to probably just be one large venue facility that was going to be constructed where it would lend itself to a really striking architectural design. And we have had experience with expressive, what we call architectural structures. However, we had not had any experience with a structure nearly as large as this one. They're very long buildings, but they're not very high buildings. And so you actually experience the roof structure. At the very early stage, we decided, let's try to see if we can convince the design team to incorporate some concrete buttresses at the outside of the building. And that opened the door for a timber arch. Now the wood is going to be acting primarily in compression, and that's where it has its greatest strength. What we were proposing there was that we would have these two large slabs of wood that would form a triangular shape. And on the bottom, we would connect them with a piece of steel here, which has a knife edge in the bottom. It's unique in that it's not just pure wood, and it's not just pure steel. So is it the wood that's resisting art? Is it the steel that's resisting it? Most of the heavy lifting will be done by the wood.
Right now we are looking into our machine that we're using for framing the Richmond Oval glulam arches. It's one of the first projects around that has utilized a hybrid truss, which is a steel frame in a V-shape where our blue laminated beams are being applied and attached to them by a steel fabricator, which is George Third & Sons. So Andy, on the 3D model that we end up creating to produce our pieces, are we providing something for George Third?
Yeah, from the 3D model, we export to assembly drawings. But the main challenge that we had on this was the V-shaped pattern that was required on these arches. Along the ends of the arch, we had a reveal for the steel shoe that goes on the bottom. Their steel had to fit perfectly to our wood.
And how many unique pieces did we get?
Unique, we had 16 different types, 13 different ones, and then some of them, there were just one-ofs on the gable ends.
We're bringing the glulams into our plant and reinforcing them with steel, adding steel to complement the strength of the wood. We have to make 52 85-foot trusses we can put together on the site to give us a 328-foot total span. So we put two of them together into the V structure you'll see, and we add more steel to strengthen it all up to make it into the final truss. We start by screwing a plate to the top of the glulams. In some locations, it's a piece of plate like this. In other locations, it's a piece of wide flange like you see on the top here. We brought the pieces together into the V shape. And if you look down the beam, you'll see one of the trickier parts of the job. It's not only curved, but now it has a dish in the beam. quite a bit of geometry to figure that out and build the jigs so that when we put the pieces in, this one has to arc up and this one has to arc down for the two pieces to come together. And the next thing that goes on here is what we call our skate blade. So here you can see how we address this skate blade to the truss. Then the next piece will be put in here, and then these two pieces attached to the join. You can see here, this is where the air conditioning heating plenum is placed inside the V. Good way to hide it from view, and there'll also be the sprinkler system, the wiring for the lighting, etc., are all hidden in the top here. Each one of these pieces weighs approximately 20 tons when it leaves our plant. It's a very tight schedule and a lot of new things that we haven't done before. So that's a pretty tall order. There's a lot of hours goes into them, a lot of work, a lot of manpower. So the shop is running 18 hours a day, and we presently are working all weekends as well until the job is finished. So.
Well, today we're going to be doing a big lift, and it's kind of a critical lift. It's going to be the first double glulam going up in between the two end pieces that are supported by the false work. So, very intricate geometry on this, and the main stress today is that it fits. But I'm fully confident that it will.
Each 85-foot truss gets sent to the site, and they're erected in four sections to make a 325-foot arch. We put the first one up, goes from the concrete buttress structure that's here to a false work structure, sort of a scaffolding that we build here, and it gets placed into that, and then same thing on the other side of the job site, again from the buttress to the false work. We take these two arches and we assemble them down here on the ground, and then our crane picks up the two pieces, now a 40-ton lift, and it picks it up. And once they're in place, we actually jack these ones towards the two center ones, make the connections that we have to make, and we also glue the glulams together so we get a complete arch from one side to the other. A little bit more challenging than shoeing horses, but it'll be a landmark in Vancouver for a long time.
Lawrence.
So early on, we proposed a solid wood 2x4 panel structure, and that they would just be placed on top of these arches here. So I went to my partner, Gerald Epp, and suggested we frame this entire 6.5-acre roof with pine beetle wood. How exactly we do that, we don't know yet, but what really brings the design over the top is this whole pine beetle wood panel that rests in between the arches.
Part of the challenge, I suppose, is to see if there's a way of using large volumes of pine beetle wood that is perceived by the marketplace as being inferior, when in fact, structurally, it's not at all inferior. What we're trying to do with these wood panels they had to span between arches. The arches were going to go the long 100-meter span, but in between these arches, we wanted to use this covering for the roof in pine beetle wood. Well, there's no way that 2x4s are going to span 40 some odd feet. Also, as the design developed, they did not want the big massive roof that had no articulation to it. And they had their own thematic ideas of what this roof might represent. It's a very large structure. It's right beside the airport. Well, this is evolving into a roof that has curvature to follow the arch form of the base structure, and also has curvature in the other way to create these pillow-like elements which kind of take off the north end, peel apart, and become these feathers. So, increasing complexity was being introduced in the project. But we knew the steel industry had to deal with that. So it wasn't going to be just a slam dunk for them. They were going to have to solve the three-dimensional complexity problems associated with that shape. That led to another unique constraint in our mind to develop a wood panel that would now solve the structural problems, solve an acoustical problem, and be economical at the same time. And so we did some experiments at the shop, and this idea of staggering the 2x4s led to another thought, which was, well, if we stagger them once, maybe we can stagger them again. In so doing, we can create a panel that's made out of 2x4s that now has a large space over top of them. Well, how do we get the sound waves into that space? Well, you make it only 2 or 3 feet long at intervals, enough to just stitch the adjacent 2x4 to it. So now we're talking about a much deeper panel. As the depth of the panel increases, its structural efficiency increases, and so that drives us to do a lot of testing. So that testing process has taken us a little longer than we thought. So that gave us also some reason, because we have solved those kind of problems with wood in the past. It might be interesting for people to understand what's possible with just ordinary 2x4s.
It's going absolutely great. We thought in our wildest dream, I recall conversations with Gerry and Angus, we talked about we should be able to get 10, maybe 12 panels if we're optimistic. We exceeded that by 5 panels. We've installed 17 panels on a good day. And so today was a milestone. We reached actually half the amount of total panels. The total project has 461 panels, and I think we've done 218 to date. So far we've installed 8 bays, almost 8 bays, one panel shy, and there's a total of 14 bays on this roof, so we're getting to the three-quarter mark point. You can see here, this is the last bay, we're just finishing off installation. There's one panel missing, and you can see those cables over there. So basically what happens is we land a panel or a bay, and then the electricians come behind and they put their all their wires in place, and you may see those pipes sticking out of the end of the panel. They get connected for the sprinkler. The main line runs inside that arch as well. Once they're finished, we come behind and we stitch the two panels together side to side, and that becomes then a unit. The biggest challenge the guys are facing here is two challenges. One is the wind or the weather. But the other big challenge is that below us, there's a lot of activity that's happening on the slab. We're not the only ones here. Ahead of us, we have the steel guys, GTS, and they need the space with the big cranes and their man lifts to install the arches. But behind us, we have Conforce and Canadian, who install hollow cores and concrete for the main slab. And so the biggest challenge is coordinating with other trades to make sure that nobody is in each other's way. You notice here is what we have is the drag struts. Over here we have to bridge the gap between the two plywood panels. This is a very important connection from an engineering point of view. This collects all the forces, and then we bridge over it with another layer of plywood. But we have to build it up. The problem is that it's not consistent. So For us, the challenge is to find the right elevation. So sometimes we have to build up, sometimes we have to go less than that, but that's one big task that takes a lot of time here.